Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Please be seated. What an absolutely beautiful day. And it is so incredibly wonderful to be gathered together here, to be gathered together with millions of others throughout the world shouting, Alleluia, Christ is risen. And I'm grateful for the hard work of our choir and our musicians and all the people that have worked so hard to make this day so beautiful. And I want to preface that wherever you are on your spiritual journey, you're deeply welcome here. And we all share in the beauty of gathering together. Whether you've come out of an obligation to a loved one or a sort of nostalgia for what you remember growing up, or your parents have dragged you here, or a loved one, or you live here week in and week out, regardless of your questions or doubt or faith, you're welcome. And my task today is to preach what the church believes, regardless of where you are on your journey. And my hope is that in doing so, that it will lead you deeper in your own spiritual journey. For me, this faith has been vitally life-changing. And I pray that proclaiming what the Christian faith believes will deepen your life and fill you with hope and help you too shout, Alleluia, Christ is risen. You know, on the surface, from the view of where I get most of my information, Instagram and TikTok, people see the bright colors and chocolate-covered Easter bunnies and children dressed up in seersucker and bow ties. And I did this earlier this week, and I told those of y'all that were here last night that I typed Easter into Google. I wanted to see what Google would say, and it brought up all these pictures on the right side. They were simply images of bunnies and colorful eggs and a chick. That was it. And I think people see beauty and joy, and we want to celebrate. I mean, we have resisted Lent, all of Lent. There have been more Easter egg hunts the whole season of Lent than I could ever imagine. We so badly yearn for beauty and joy. You might say it's contagious. But these illustrations are not what makes this gathering so beautiful. Not in the least. As one of your clergy, I've been privy to more than a few of the harder stories that I've been privileged to hear from you and many others. What makes Easter so beautiful is that we show up to sing Alleluia despite the weight of all that is carried. The insecurity, the illnesses, the shame, the broken relationships, the addictions, the diagnoses, the losses, the fear, God, the overwhelming fear, the overwhelming nature of so much of our world. I know y'all know this more than anybody. Life can be a whole lot, almost insurmountable yet for the grace of God. And yet we still boldly show up here to sing Alleluia, to proclaim that God's story is still continuing to unfold. Anne Lamott said it best, although I think she was quoting the author Barbara Johnson, when she said, "We are Easter people living in a Good Friday world." On Good Friday, just 2 days ago, we once again realized how broken our world is, that our human striving for good and peace can destroy what is most precious. And we continue to see that every day, Good Friday being lived out. There was an image from last week that is frozen in my mind. It's a picture from Jerusalem from last Sunday, 1 week ago. Christians marching with giant palm leaves from the Mount of Olives to the Damascus Gate. Now, with a handful of y'all, 4 years ago, we got to go and walk in those same footsteps. But 4 years ago, that trip was possible because the world was a drastically different place. And so this image stands out because in the midst of war and loss and chaos, pilgrims from around the world have shown up with giant palm leaves against the backdrop of war. And the question I ask is why? Because the truth they have come to know is more important than safety. To travel to a place filled with uncertainty. And today, around the world and in that place especially, people are singing, Alleluia, Christ is risen. What makes Easter so beautiful is that we gather, as we gather in spite of this Good Friday world, in spite of the loss and grief and pain, because we are resurrection people. Mary, the mother of James, and Mary Magdalene and Salome headed to the tomb. They encounter a young man dressed in white in an empty tomb, proclaiming that Jesus has been raised from the dead. They brought spices, maybe some oil, signs of their grief. Signs of their grief and loss so that they could anoint the body of their friend. They knew the world. They watched people be crucified all of the time. They knew how to handle death. The death of their beloved friend wasn't what makes this story life-changing. Death was expected and normal. You show up. You bring spices, maybe a casserole. You anoint. My own interpretation into the gospel. Death is normal. You grieve. Mark tells us that they fled the tomb with terror and amazement. Everything they had known about the world was just proven wrong. Empire did not have the final word. Death did not have the final word. Grief did not have the final word. We are here so that we can proclaim that God has the final word. God always has the final word, and the story is still not finished. We gather here because we know that life, death, and resurrection are all part of God's story. And God's story is still not finished. We are Easter people living in a Good Friday world. And if we're honest, that's both amazing and terrifying. You know, one of the things that our prayer book gives us instruction for what it means to live the Christian life. And on page 855, it tells us what our ministry is. The ministry of laypersons is to represent Christ and his church, to bear witness to him wherever they may be, according to the gifts given them, and to carry on Christ's work of reconciliation in this world. I mean, that's what it means to be people of faith, to bear witness to resurrection. This means that every small little action that you and I have to offer that bears hope and love in this world is critically important because it is God's continuing work of telling the rest of the story. every little thing that we do, sharing kindness with a stranger, forgiving a person who's caused a grievance, tending a garden or caring for a loved one, building kinship with people that are yearning for kinship, forgiving ourselves, mentoring another person, or just seeking to listen and understand before we respond to the person in front of us. Each small action is a part of God's continuing work of bearing witness to resurrection in this world. We get to be involved in this amazing and maybe a little terrifying work of God's continuing story to unfold. We have purpose and agency to tell the story that others are struggling to see. And maybe we still show up with spices and oil, but we get to do so with hope and courage, knowing that it's not the end of the story. Yes, we live in a Good Friday world, but we are Easter people. God's story is still unfolding and breathing resurrection to the world. I mean, look at this. We're gathered here so that we can learn how to share God's love. How hopeful is that? You and I are a part of the story. May we all proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Amen.